online webinar on partition literature. I would like to welcome you, sir, to our speaker, Dr. Tarun Kumar Sen, retired professor from Hindu College, and a very hearty welcome to all my colleagues from Department of English and from Shamlal College as well. And very special welcome to all the participants who have joined us today on this virtual platform to hear the lecture. And although our principal sir could not join us due to his some important engagements, but he has sent his best wishes and good wishes to us. Today's webinar is based upon partition literature. Partition, a word that sustains in itself vivid emotions, and it suddenly paints numerous pictures in our mind, rushing people towards trains, piles of corpses, deprived children, blood, riots, rape, and a chain of events. And it was a time of so much upheaval and calamities. And no matter how much we have read, how much we have discussed or seen, any medium associated with partition makes us feel hopelessly curious. And to rouse this curiosity one level high, we have invited today our honorable guest, Dr. Tarun Kumar Sen, who is retired from Hindu College and will be sharing his thought upon the metaphor of madness in partition literature. Dr. Tarun Kumar Sen is an independent scholar and writer who has authored many books. Some of them are as follows: Witnessing Partition, Memory, History, Fiction in 2010. He edited Bruised Memories, Communal Violence and the Writer in 2002. He co-edited a book Translating Partition in 2001. He also co-edited Looking Back, India's Partition 70 Years On in 2017 with Rakshanda Jaleel and Dev Jani Sen Gupta. Recently, he edited the Golkan's book of South Asian of science fiction, which came in 2019, and its second volume will be coming very soon in 2021. These are and many more works he has written. Now I welcome and request Dr. Tarun Kumar Sen that please you can start now with your lecture and share your thoughts with us and all the participants. Welcome, sir.
Thank you so much. Yes, it's a pleasure and an honor to be here. Wish the times were different. It would have been so good to be physically present at your college, perhaps giving the lecture in your seminar room. But times are such that, well, we have to abide by the circumstances. So I guess Zoom is the option for now. Truly glad to be able to present my ideas to students and colleagues from your college and perhaps some other friends who have joined on the metaphor of madness in partition literature. So I should say at the outset that I will not be covering all of partition literature. It's a vast terrain, and some of which, as you mentioned, I did my research on the subject and published a book. Witnessing Partition is a study, a fairly lengthy study. So I commend that to those who are really interested in the details. So I'm just taking a selection of texts. And this selection is drawn from the Northwest context. So in other words, I'm delimiting my field right at the outset. I will not be addressing the Bengal partition at all in this lecture, though some of the implications of what I say may have a bearing with respect to our understanding of, say, the Bengal partition and the literature produced in its wake. So in this then, presentation, I first will begin with a general sort of introduction of the subject. The madness which people sometimes associate with the moment of 1947 was often a term used very euphemistically To understand better how that term came to be deployed, let's take a step back and sort of just rapidly summarize some of the important history, which I hope will not be too tedious. I'll just be brief before launching into my reading of some of the important texts. So then, in this presentation, I plan to focus on the psychological aspects of the massive and unprecedented dislocation and forced migration in the wake of the partition. As we know, extreme forms of collective violence came to the fore after the communal polarization of 1947-48, marked by ethnic cleansing, especially in the Punjab. Also, for the first time, extensive targeting of women and children and preemptive attacks, more so across Northwest India. This became especially prevalent after the positing of the hostage theory, according to which the welfare of minority communities was to be predicated on the treatment of such communities in the other nation. The resultant spread of fear and panic led to 10 to 15 million people being compelled to leave behind their homes and migrate across the newly declared Radcliffe Line, which was announced only after the declaration of independence on 14th August for Pakistan and 15th August for India. And the award was announced on 17th August. Some of the better connected and wealthy migrants found a place in airplanes and flew across. Others, including many Sindhis, left by ships sailing from cities like Karachi on their way to Bombay. Some came via ship from Bombay to Karachi, Muslim migrants. But the majority were forced to risk the perilous train routes as the railway lines became killing zones where innocents were mercilessly slaughtered. They were forced to take recourse to the dusty roads where kafilas of refugees stretched for miles on end, and attacks became so frequent that in one account, in Abdullah Hussain's novel Udaas Nasle, translated as The Weary Generations, a group of Muslim migrants is spared simply because the attackers on the roadside were so exhausted they could not muster up the energy for more bloodshed. So the scale and extent of uprooting and demographic transformation during 47-48 had reverberations that echo till today, manifested, I argue, in the form of historical trauma. In early accounts, the partition was often referred to, as I pointed out earlier, as an outbreak of madness, aberration, which became a kind of shorthand for referring to often incomprehensible situations and experiences confronted by migrants in the process of location. But let's actually take again a step back to the history of the moment, especially with reference to the partitioning of institutions. So as Alok, Sareen, and Anirudh Kala have shown in their fine essay on this subject, after the partitioning of populations during 47-48, a decision was taken at the highest level. Here I am obviously echoing Manto's story, but this is speaking of actual situations at the time. So the transfer of prisoners was accomplished in April and in October 1948 in two tranches, episodes. So 4,078 non-Muslim prisoners were sent across the border from Pakistan, 3,761 Muslim prisoners from India were sent across the border to Pakistan. Then came the decision to partition the mental hospitals. So there were about 20 odd mental hospitals at the time, most of them in India, three in West Pakistan. So these were located at Lahore, Hyderabad, Sindh, and Peshawar. East Pakistan actually had no mental hospital. And there were less than 50 psychiatrists in India in 1947. The decision to transfer the patients in 1948 led to the actual event. On 6 December 1950, 450 Indian patients were transferred from West Pakistan, and they were, of course, Hindus and Sikhs. 282 of them, the Punjabis amongst them, were sent to the Amritsar Mental Asylum. 162 non-Punjabis were sent to Ranchi. Then we have 233 Muslim patients sent from India to Pakistan, And all of this was accomplished, as we can see, 3 years and 4 months after the formal accomplishment of partition. It was as if they had been forgotten by the two nations. A further disturbing fact that Alok Sarin and Anirudh Kala point out is that there were 650 Hindu and Sikh patients in the various asylums in Pakistan at the time of partition, but only 317 were transferred. The rest of them, more than 300 of them, died, likely due to negligence. And not a single Muslim patient was transferred to India. The same was the case on the other side. Only about half the patients were alive at the time of partition were actually transferred. So we can actually discern how communal attitudes here are percolated down into the institutional spaces. Therefore, running against the grain of the Hippocratic Oath and the ethics of course, medical practitioners. So, having said this, let me now turn to Sadat Hasan Manto. The students are studying his story, Toba Tek Singh, one of the most prolific of writers. Ironically enough, he was stricken with silence for 2 months after migrating from Bombay before responding to the event initially with his short, ironic, and almost grotesque vignettes titled Siya Hashir, or Black Margins. But Manto's masterpiece, written in the 50s, in the wake of time spent by him in the Lahore Mental Asylum, while undergoing treatment not for lunacy or any illness as such, but for alcoholism. So this masterpiece is, of course, Toba Tek Singh. In this modern fable, Manto combines a sharply satirical depiction of the final moments of the departing colonial empire with a poignant allegory about the experience of partition here, as Leslie Fleming has shown. For Manto, the deportation of inmates from Lahore on the basis of region and religious identity was both real and a metaphor for the descent into collective debasement at this time. The portrayal of the character Toba Tek Singh, his real name, as we know, is Bishan Singh, the portrayal for his quest for the location of his village after the forming of the two nation state allows for an ironic questioning of the logic of the two nation theory and the forced displacement that resulted. For Toba Tek Singh, despite being confined in the asylum, imagined roots in his homeland far outweigh the claims of nationalism based on territorial sovereignty. For him, an affiliation to an idea of vatan or homeland remains crucial in the face of what Veena Das calls, in Life and Words, world annihilating violence. His death in no man's land after his mad satyagraha, when his sturdy legs give way after a final shriek, is a tragic expression of Toba Tek Singh's refusal to succumb to an order predicated on instrumental rationality and a scissors and paste logic, fixated on enumeration based on shaky demographics. So the Punjabi phrase, and this is something I was reminded of by Farooq Khan. So the Punjabi phrase, dur fite muh, or shame on you, as translated by the translator H.K. Trivedi, crystallizes Toba Tek Singh's revulsion at the processes that culminate in a degradation of spirit, even if in the name of lofty proclamations of national pride and glory. Truly, the madman here possesses a kernel of sanity far surpassing the supposed rationale underlying the Radcliffe decree, with its complete lack of understanding of the extent of intimacy which linked the intertwined communities. Even as society imploded into horrific mob-based violence that approached near genocidal levels in the Punjab. And Paul Brass has actually coined the term retributive genocide to refer to the kind of preemptive violence that took place with mobs striking at the other community on the presumption that they may be possibly mobilized to attack later. So here the asylum as microcosm becomes a brilliant metaphor for all that was amiss in the subcontinent in 1947. Now, the word asylum has its roots in the Greek word asylon or inviolate. Later, the word acquired derogatory connotations with the use of the term lunatic asylum after the confinement of the mentally ill began in the 17th century. Remember that the mentally ill were not always confined in asylums. Prior to the 17th century in Europe, for example, they were allowed to roam free. Often they were regarded as people who could somehow, especially the more benign, mentally ill cases, who might have a kind of privileged access to a form of transcendental truth. But after the 17th century, regardless of whether the mentally ill were regarded were seen to be dangerous or not, they began to be confined just as prisoners were confined, and this was further accentuated in the 19th century after the advent of the discipline of psychology, which purported to be a science which could enable a kind of curing of mental illness. Based primarily, of course, as we know, on the idea of the talking cure. This model, of course, was brought across to India and in effect implemented during the era of the Raj with colonial psychiatry, of course, following a particular term. The first psychiatrist to come to India was Konigsberger, who was Maharaja Ranjit Singh's private psychiatrist in the Punjab in the early 19th century. After Ranjit Singh's death, he opened the first psychiatric ward in India. Again, this is drawing on Alok Sarian's work. Subsequently, asylums were opened, as was discussed earlier, in the colonial era, but certain attitudes still persisted, especially a certain kind of racial demarcation. So there was an exclusive asylum for British patients. And as you remember in Montrose's story, there's a reference to the privileged treatment expected by the Anglo-Indian prisoners. So segregation existed in the context of psychiatric treatment. It was not necessarily conducted along purely, once again, objective or rational grounds. Of course, Montrose takes this to its logical extreme. The absurd rendering of the asylum's partitioning actually deflates the lofty pretensions, as we've already sort of seen. His gibberish accentuates this critique of institutional derangement, which was afoot at the time, whether that of political parties, juridical entities, media barons, or the foot soldiers committing terrible crimes in the name of religion, or maybe even for just mercenary reasons. In effect, Montrose initiates a rethinking of the very concept of madness, much bandied about at the time. As we recall, even Gandhi appealed to communities not to fight madness with madness. The term was used by one of the first historians to come to terms with partition based on interviews with survivors. G.D. Khosla refers to this outbreak of madness, as he puts it in his work, Stern Reckoning. But Toba Tek Singh brings up a completely different interpretation. It dispels such illusions about this moment of rupture and extreme violence, as its protagonist becomes an embodiment of the ontological disarray and disequilibrium being faced by the people displaced from their homes, from their ways of living and livelihood, and their existential mooring at the time. The significance of this intervention cannot be underestimated, especially in the context of the failure of psychiatrists to engage at the time with the question of trauma, which was being undergone by millions displaced. As again demonstrated by Sanjeev Jain and Alok Sarin, with the exception of Gardner Murphy's study In the Minds of Men, commissioned by UNESCO, 1947. Though there was some attempt at social rehabilitation in camps, and though resettlement, especially in the north, did occur with a certain kind of attempt at through the measure of providing land left behind by those who had left for the other side in the form of graded cuts. A percentage of the amount which had been lost was allotted. But effectively, there was not really sufficient psychological rehabilitation, as argued by Shelley Jain in her book, The Unspeakable Mind. So there was no counseling, there was no therapy or treatment awaiting those traumatized. Even the concept of PTSD, of course, had not been devised at the time, though, of course, people were to some extent aware of Freud's theory of shell shock, which formed the basis for, of course, the treatment of the World War I soldiers who suffered from symptoms akin to post-traumatic stress disorder. So yes, the particular manifestations, as Freud pointed out, were often in the form of nightmares, flashbacks, a kind of persistent sense of numbness, which only abated gradually over time and sometimes not completely. So he spoke of, as you will recall, I think it's a background text in the partition literature course, in his essay on, of course, the subject of mourning and melancholy, this melancholic aspect being associated with what he calls repetition. So if you do not deal adequately with the ghosts of the past, you will be forced into a kind of pattern of reenactment. And maybe that's what we're seeing today. On the contrary, if one performs perhaps mourning, if there's a kind of active involvement in mourning of all that has been lost, perhaps then there can be a working through of the residue of trauma. An additional point which maybe needs to be made with respect to the partition, especially with reference to its incomplete nature, is that in the absence of forensic investigation and systematic attempts to bring the perpetrators to justice, a certain distension has ensued. As Deepak Mehta has showed, this distension often manifests itself in the form of a hardening of positions and maybe also the advent of a certain kind of hardline right-wing ideology, where you know, there has not been an adequate coming to terms with the actual need of the hour to provide closure to some extent to those who faced the terrible losses, which I have mentioned already. So to turn back to the literary representations, after sort of some time elapsed, and sometimes to achieve this kind of well, reckoning, you need the certain distance provided by time. So in the second generation, or in the writing which emerged in the at least around 50 years after the partition, we find that the phantasmatic after effects relayed across time are dealt with, especially in, say, a novel like Joginder Pal's story, novel Khwabru, translated by Sukrita Paul Kumar as Sleepwalkers. So he depicts the situation of his central character, Diwane Maulvi Sahib. Now, as you know, in pre-colonial times, madness in our country too was often associated with a certain kind of perhaps divine lunacy, the Junoon or Divanapan notion. Though that's not to say, of course, one must romanticize the treatment of the mentally ill. It could often be also very cruel, with people chained up quite ruthlessly. But here we have a particular character, Diwane Maulvi Sahib. He's a migrant from Lucknow who believes that he is still in Lucknow, despite the fact that his entire family has migrated to Karachi. So this delusion is strengthened due to the concerted attempts by the Muhajirs, that is the migrants from India, to transplant Lucknowi Tehzeeb, the Nafasat and Nazakat, as we know. So that culture was sought to be transplanted to Karachi. The illusion of remaining in his beloved home city is also sustained by his family, who fear a worse fate for him if awakened to the truth. Eventually, his assiduously fostered delusion is shattered when tensions grow between the Sindhis and the Muhajirs, with a bomb blast in their neighborhood jolting Diwane Maulvi Sahib into a late realization of his true situation. His consequent desire to return to Lucknow is destined to remain unfulfilled, even as his relatives seek to restore him to his so-called deluded state. For a metaphoric madness had seemed to have migrated in the wake of partition, with the time of rupture continuing to haunt these people, the community of Muhajirs, even as Karachi became a flashpoint for sectarian tensions. Migrants often seek to find roots in memory, as Salman Rushdie put it in his first novel, Grimus. And this notion is exemplified in a different way in Intizar Hussain's nostalgia for neem trees, which do not grow in Pakistan, where the neem tree becomes a metaphor for civilizational unity, which must be preserved in memory, even after going into exile. So you're reading his students from English Honours read this novel, Basti, in this course. I hope you'll sort of have a chance to read more about Hussain's views on civilizational unity and the memories which are preserved in the knowledge of especially mythological narration. There is a darker tale by Intizar Hussain, Barium Carbonate, where refugee life is reduced to penury, a life which could be seen as equivalent to, in his depiction, the life of rats, in a kind of reversal or inversion, once again, of evolutionary logic. This is a much darker tale than Basti. Another gender dimension of this traveling madness or phantasmatic afterlife of collective trauma becomes visible in Shashi Deshpande's story, Independence Day. So this story, written 50 years after the partition, depicts the situation of Sindhi migrants who find their way to Bangalore. And it is narrated from a child's point of view as a memory of an encounter with refugees during the run-up to Independence Day. The narrator reflects on the image of partition migration, miles and miles of refugees moving in two opposite directions, two independent lines, each unaware, it seems, of each other, unquote. She speaks of the way we stashed away all the ugliness, the uprooting, the killing, the raping, in some dusty, forgotten archive, what Anant Taneja calls archival amnesia, retaining only the sanitized pictures we are comfortable with. In the story, the child narrator is dressed up as Bharat Mata and taken to meet a Sindhi refugee lady who, however, starts making strange keening sounds, since she is reminded by the sight of her own daughter lost during the arduous journey across the border. Later, when the child narrator goes to the Independence Day function at her school and performs as Bharat Mata on stage, she cannot see the audience before her, for the image of the grieving Sindhi woman interposes itself before her eyes. So this story exemplifies the duality of trauma, in Kathy Carruth's terms, as a wound afflicted not just on the body, but also on the mind and soul. The wound in the mind may be experienced too soon, though, and manifests itself in the form of uncanny repetition, as we were earlier discussing, in the form of nightmares and flashbacks. Trauma thus returns to haunt the survivor later on. Here we find a double telling of the unbearable story of a death, that's the lady's daughter, as well as the unbearable story of survival, in which the celebration of the nation's arrival is clouded by the cries emanating from the wound in the mind, which continues to speak. Quote, they have lost everything, unquote, says one character, gesturing towards the multiple actual and symbolic deaths of the time. So above the sound of the girl singing, quote, Jhanda Uncha Rahe Hamara, unquote, the uncanny sound of the keening woman who's uttering scarcely human syllables remains audible. In its own way, Deshpande's story contributes to the possibility of building a testimonial community in which the hyphenated nature of independence dash partition remains visible, and the differentiated effects, after effects of collective trauma may be negotiated. Let me now turn to a more recent collection, which brings us almost, yes, up to the 21st century. And we can see how this understanding of trauma and madness has evolved very nicely in this wonderful collection by Anirudh Kala, The Unsafe Asylum. So here we find the vulnerability of the asylum as an inviolate space becomes even more apparent. The notable absence in Manto's story, Tobatek Singh, was the figure of the psychiatrist. Kala centers his stories on precisely such mental health professionals, beginning with Dr. Iqbal Junaid Hussain. In his story, quote, no forgiveness necessary. So stationed in the Lahore Mental Hospital, Hussain is confronted with the grim task of enumerating Hindu and Muslim patients, what we were talking about earlier, to be transferred to India after partition. However, his death at the hands of a grieving Sikh motorcyclist is an instance of the horrors awaiting people inside, just outside the hospital gates. This story is recapitulated many years later when his son travels to India in 1979, ostensibly to attend a cricket match, and tracks down Ramnik Singh, his father's killer, on the basis of the identity tag that he had dropped near Hussein's body. So rather than revenge, the son, Asif Junaid Hussain, also a psychiatrist, is keen to hear the story recounted in full. Ramnik had vowed to kill 10 Muslims after finding his son murdered at home. Iqbal simply happened to be on the road at the time and was thus shot by Ramnik. In this story, the violent passions of the era are retrospectively invoked with the distance of time, and a reckoning of sorts is achieved through truth-telling, though without forgiveness, indeed, none is expected. Significantly, we are introduced here to the minor characters who become more sort of important as the stories unfold further. Ruldas Singh and Fateh Muhammad, patients in the Lahore Hospital who have recovered, but given that they have nowhere to go, are allowed to stay on. Like Mantu's inmates, Rulda and Fatu try to make sense of the world and eventually conclude that the big sign saying Mental Hospital Lahore should be put outside so that it is clear on which side of the gate is the actual mental hospital. So this moment of black humor recapitulates and again extends Mantu's inversion of the relationship between the asylum and the world. It may be that the patients are saner than those outside, a claim drawn out by the tragic assassination of Dr. Iqbal outside the gates. Later in the story, Partitioning Madness, Ruda is to be sent to India and the question of choice is broached. And I here now offer a few quotes from the story. So the big exchange happened 3 years ago. It started then, but it is not finished. Mentals are, after all, the rear end of mankind. Are we mankind? Do we even count as mankind? Asks Ruda. Everything that can be counted counts and has to be meticulously counted and divided between the two countries. Even us. Then why were we not asked our preferences? Everyone else was, but we have no legal capacity. People outside do. So they knew that a million people might die and still went ahead. This is the last question, Rulda. So once again, the narrative folds back into the tale of Toba Tek Singh, interrogating the basis for partition, demonstrably on grounds that were far from rational, especially to the inhabitants of the hospital, who were denied agency along the way and excluded from decision-making that would irrevocably alter their lives, and in Rulda's case, send him to India far from his hometown. I will conclude with reference to the last story, Rulda's discharge. In the year 1984, relatives from Delhi came to take Rulda from the Amritsar hospital where he had spent so many years. En route, they were warned to get off the train from Amritsar to Delhi, since news has begun to come about Mrs. Gandhi's assassination and the beginning of a new wave of violence. They misjudge the situation and arrive in Delhi, where Rulda's relative is beaten to death on the platform at the station. While he manages to flee, Rulda's fate remains uncertain. In the midst of ongoing carnage, Rulda begins piteously asking people if they know the location of a mental hospital in the city where he wants to go. The tragic irony of the situation of displaced mental patients is thus further underlined in a new scenario of targeted revenge killings and hatred of the other. The madness of the world becomes apparent once again as the category of madness is turned inside out, although whether Rulda will find sanctuary remains unclear. The metaphoric resonances of his predicament are unmistakable, an extension of Mantu's descriptive language as homage and as a mode of empathic unsettlement of received assumptions about identity and belonging from a minority standpoint, in this case, the Sikh community during 1984. Color stories thus confirm the potential of partition literature's literary testimony as a way of negotiating lost histories through allegorical and metaphoric forms of creative reenactment. We find here a contestation of received definitions institutionalized across the years, including that of madness. In effect, paraphrasing Foucault, the fictive asylum becomes a mirror to the moving chaos of the world of 1947, embodying the continuing distress of those marginalized and excluded in the process of nation-state formation. As we have seen, the term madness was first used as shorthand, denoting incomprehension of the changes afoot, or as euphemism to allay anxieties at the enormity of what was happening. In Montreux, the connotations of the term change as the mental hospital becomes a mirror of the larger whole, and the mad ones are seen as the truth tellers and witnesses, especially to what it seems. However, there is also, besides the idea of truth telling in the older sense of the mystic era, there's also a post-Freudian concern with unmasking the illusions generated by institutional paradigms, whether that of the colonial psychiatric regime or that of the nation states in the making, for whom the patients are simply pawns in a geopolitical game. Freud's ideas of the unconscious and repression and consequent denial are relevant in this context, especially as we see in these representations of the belated effects of trauma, especially in Joginder Pal's narratives and Shashi Deshpande's story, which relies on an understanding of post-traumatic stress disorder modulated in an Indian and specifically Bangalorean context. Finally, in Anirudh Kala's collection, we have seen there's a metafictional and self-reflexive account of mental illness with the persistence of symptoms and ways in which unresolved residues of trauma remaining are negotiated. And ultimately, madness is no longer available in this particular set of stories as cliche, as a cliched way of oversimplifying historical reality. Rather, there's an unpacking of the changing valence of this metaphor across generations, an attempt to work through its implications in a contemporary context. So I think I'll stop there. Maybe just flag at the very end, a very important, I think, statement by Kavita Punjabi, where do we go from here? The question might arise. I'm anticipating questions to come. And Kavita Punjabi has a fascinating essay in Urvashi Bhutalia's collection of essays, Partition the Long Shadow, where she says that we need to acknowledge mutual culpability. We need to have a kind of better sense of our respective, as it were, responsibility. If we can accept this mutually on both sides of the border, perhaps then we can come to a kind of mutual reparation, perhaps even mutual forgiveness. With that, the prospect of moving on, perhaps a thought which is kind of relevant in the context of the resumption of dialogue, which is currently on between the two estranged nations. Thank you very much. If there are questions, I would be glad to field them.
Thank you very much, sir. As you incorporate many books and short stories about this partition and how the calamity of partition deeply touched and affected the people at that time. And even now we can feel that how whenever we read something and we hear about this partition calamity, we can easily identify with everything and how suddenly change the mindset of people, and people who are familiar suddenly became unfamiliar. The land which was our own, that again became, for many people, it was like unfamiliar land. Thank you so much, sir. And now I request Rajarishi to ask the question if there is any in the chat box. Rajarishi.
You are muted. Rajarishi needs to be unmuted.
Please unmute yourself.
I think he is unmuted at his end.
Yes.
needs to be done at the
host. He can unmute himself. No, your voice is not audible.
Ah, he's come. Yeah, Rajesh, can you? No, you can go.
Your voice is not audible, Raj Rishi.
Does that need to be done by the host?
Yeah, I just checked, sir.
Hello.
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Yes.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. Nice to see you here. And good afternoon to all my colleagues here and all my students who are attending this talk. I really thank Tarun Sen sir for coming up with such an informative talk and where you have discussed such a wide array of literature surrounding partition and the way madness is represented here. I would ask anyone of the audience, if you have any questions, kindly please come up with your questions. I'm yet to receive any on the chat box.
Yes, time to break the silence. Very poignant metaphor in the context.
I think there is a question from Mir Muhammad Ali. I think he wants to ask something. So, Mir Muhammad Ali, would you please continue? Would you please ask? I think...
Yes, you can unmute yourself or type it in, whichever you prefer, right?
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah, thank you so much, Tanu sir, for such a wonderful talk. Just I want to know one thing. While I am working on Sadat Hasan Manto, I just want a kind of clarification. In one of your essay, you have talked about historical drama, how it is working on a collective sphere. Yes. Now, my point is that when we are talking about historical drama, there are in many countries, Holocaust trauma is part of this one, if I'm not wrong.
Yes.
There are other events that has happened, which come generally under the rubric of this historical drama.
Yes.
So in that way, can we differentiate partition trauma from the an umbrella called that historical trauma? I mean, when I'm talking about historical trauma, it's a kind of an umbrella term. Can we specify in that way when I am doing a kind of a historical research on that? Can we specify, can we took it, I mean, out of the umbrella and be it as a unique mode of study called partition trauma? Can we call it?
Okay, thank you for that. Very good question. Yeah, very helpful. I always appreciate it when fellow researchers come on board and have sort of interesting things to say, indicating that you are also taking the debate so seriously, and perhaps you in your own work may provide fresh insight. So let me offer my own understanding, which might help you to think further about this question that you've raised. So as I understand it, yes, the term historical trauma, I am indebted, of course, to the work of Dominic La Capra. So the theorist Dominic La Capra is the one who first posited this term, distinguishing perhaps historical trauma from the more individuated variants of trauma which we associate with classical psychoanalysis and trauma theory based on the individual experience of trauma. So this, of course, goes straight back to Freud, once again, the theory of shell shock. But one can see possibilities even in Freud's thinking for extending his analysis beyond the domain of the, subconscious, of the individual, where the trauma, as it were, is lodged and where it sort of becomes so difficult to reckon with, and which, of course, manifests itself in the context of later flashbacks and later persistent, perhaps repetitive behavior, as I've been discussing. But I think even in Freud, because he was looking at a mass phenomenon, the phenomenon of soldiers who are returning from the battlefield, he was able to generalize somewhat. Maybe he didn't take it in the direction of a kind of collective unconscious, as Jung did, but maybe there's an interesting way in which maybe we could sort of connect Freud and Jung here, that the idea of historical trauma applicable to entire communities, perhaps, then as we are here referring to, could be sort of productively thought of as something lodged in a kind of collective unconscious or political unconscious, which then continues to sort of generate these pathological affects. Now, I know you're interested in psychopathology. So that's precisely the terrain which one is thinking of here. And it's very tricky when it comes to partition, as you already rightly identified, because of the kind of reciprocal nature of the violence, what I was referring to as kind of forms of mutual violence. Now, at first, people sort of resorted to the easy explanation that, say, approximately equal numbers of people died on each side. So it sort of balanced out, let's forget it and move on. But it's never as simple as that, as we are all aware. It was highly targeted, planned for, rationalized, given the kind of ideological engineering that was afoot at that time. There were demobilized soldiers who were at the forefront of the violence, leading civil militias of particular communities, and the attempt was to eradicate the other. So it took on a genocidal form. So this actually takes me back to your, I think, initial question about the uniqueness, therefore, of partition violence. Can one think of a kind of gray zone in the context of partition violence? This would be my question, again, which we can reflect upon further, which is perhaps even more sinister than what Primo Levi identified in the context of the Holocaust. So he spoke of the situation of in the camps, for example, the concentration camps like Auschwitz, certain prisoners being forced to process, for example, the bodies of fellow prisoners and inform on them the capos who actually administered the gas chamber. So he spoke of a kind of gray zone appearing there where victims turn into perpetrators, where there's a kind of dissolving of the notion of the ethical, as it were, or the binary between good and evil. And a kind of this gray zone appears where there's a kind of indistinction. And he associates this with a kind of, zone of irresponsibility. No one can claim, responsibility for his actions. There's always, as, infamously, say, Eichmann claimed, I was just following orders. So you can exculpate yourself very easily. So in the context of partition, it's complicated. Obviously, one doesn't want to sort of suddenly claim that that all across the board people were behaving in such ways. But certainly, if we see a story like Bhisham Sani's Amritsar Aa Gaya Hai, we have arrived at Amritsar, that transformation of the identity of the main character from victim to perpetrator, it's brilliantly, I think, dramatized in that story. And it gives us a sense of how this idea of the gray zone perhaps could be further generalized, a kind of autumnal zone. Ashish Nandi has written about this as well, about many of these perpetrators who boast about the violence they've done, but they're also haunted. One of them wakes up every morning with the demon sitting on one of his toes, and he can't get rid of that sense of whether it's guilt or whether it's remorse or just a sense of being afflicted by the memory of the terrible violence which he was responsible for. So I think this idea of the gray zone would be very fruitful besides the idea of historical trauma. And yes, maybe we need to home in on the specificities of partition and differentiate it maybe from the scenarios we saw in the context of the Holocaust, by perhaps comparing it more fruitfully with experiences like, say, Rwanda, the Hutu-Tutsi violence in Rwanda, where those kinds of situations of violence of communities which were deeply intertwined and which suddenly fell at each other's throat, where what Freud called the narcissism of minor differences suddenly became magnified into a kind of explosion, which also caused a kind of societal implosion. So the binaries need to be looked at very carefully.
Exactly. Thank you so much. Even, sir, in many other stories from the Shiahashi collection also, we could find that kind of, the overlapping of these binaries. In Sarifa also, Manto's story, Sarifa also, that thing happens. Sir, another question. I mean, it's...
Perhaps there are a couple of other questions. We can come back to Meer.
Okay, sir. Sure.
There'll be time if there is time.
Thank you, sir.
I can read the questions myself. So I see, shall I just read it out, Rajesh?
Yep, I think our colleague Shivali Kharwanda has a question for you.
Yeah.
She is asking if you could talk a little on transgenerational transmission of violence and trauma.
Very good, again, question, a very interesting one. So this is something which again has been studied extensively in the context of the Holocaust and the great classic narrative in graphic form is, of course, Art Spiegelman's Mouse, which especially in the context of the second generation experience, looks back at how his father's experience of the Auschwitz camp had a kind of definitive impact on growing up in that family and had a left lasting imprint on the children's psyche, which of course he configures in the form of graphic narrative about, mice and cats, strangely enough, but it works in a kind of, again, metaphoric mode. In the context of our reality, I think, it's complex. If we think of the kind of relaying across of trauma, which I hinted at, after the initial phase of amnesia, we get more of a sense of the recognition of the problem, especially after 1984, with Urvashi Buddhalia's pioneering study, The Other Side of Silence, being sort of conducted as a result of what she witnessed, what she saw around her in the context of what was happening in Delhi. How could this have happened in independent India after so many years? Hadn't we left behind that kind of targeted killing and almost near genocidal killing of a particular community? And that too, strangely enough, the Sikhs who were supposed to be very close to them. But as a result, she went back further to the moment of partition and looked at, of course, especially the situation of the abducted women. So the extensive work done in oral history by feminist historians was crucial to uncovering some of the lost history, which I think needed to once again be aired. And as a result of her work, I think there was an increasing recognition in the new wave of scholarship that came up that this trauma had not been left behind, that the effects of violence tend to persist, and sweeping them under the carpet and saying, let's get on with the task of nation building will just not do. So yes, intergenerational transmission of trauma did occur. One can probably look to the psychological studies again done by people like Sanjeev Jain and Alok Sareen to see the ways in which this was manifested, even when in families, for example, were refugee families, where partition was not spoken of, even the very silence could affect the ways in which the next generation were brought up and the ways in which they came to think of themselves. Ashish Nandi points out to an interesting paradox here that sometimes there's a greater extent of hatred for the other in people who have not directly experienced violence. Now, why is this the case? I think his argument is salient here, that the people who experienced the violence prior to the violence had existed in a kind of multicultural space or a space of syncretism, relatively speaking. Though, of course, there were divisions. Let me not romanticize pre-partition India. And yes, especially with respect to Hindu-Muslim Pani, forms of segregation of communities on the basis of diet, on the basis of taboos relating to intermarriage. Those divisions were there. So let us not underplay those. And I think especially Muslims were more on the receiving end. But Nandi's point is that yet people had learned to coexist and learned to accommodate differences. And I think here he's following, I think, the line which was first put forward by Gandhi. And to that extent, yes, when this terrible violence broke out, those people were deeply affected, but not all of them could forgive and forget or move on. But at least they had that memory. While the next generations, often they had not lived with that memory of coexisting with the other, especially after the ghettoization of minority communities in the wake of partition violence. and in the further construction, of course, of the other as the demonic enemy in the wake of the Indo-Pak War. So this is actually a very good question about how then we must further sort of unpack the residues in this relaying across of trauma up to the our generation. One example I could give of an excellent example of a way of creatively, again, engaging with this inheritance is Vishwajyoti Ghosh's graphic anthology, This Side, That Side, Restoring Partition. So here he attempted this amazing experiment of bringing together artists and writers from the three countries, India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. And in some cases, the artist might be from Pakistan, the writer might be from India, or vice versa. Writer could be located in Dhaka, the artist in Bangalore. So you had this collaborative exercise of creating graphic narratives, not necessarily, once again, by an individual, but in a kind of process of dialogue after a workshop which he had organized. And in this process, there is a creation of a perhaps a kind of third generation perspective, which encompasses that inheritance and tries to engage with it in a very meaningful way. So one example is his own treatment of his experience of growing up close to in a neighborhood close to a school, Bluebell School, where he eventually went, and where some of the children of the refugees from East Bengal, who had been sent first to Dandakaranya, their children ultimately, in certain cases, were sent across to Delhi to study far away from their family. And these would often be, of course, lower caste families. And so that poignant experience of being regarded by these less privileged children as their prince, because it so happened that his grandmother was the principal of the school and was a social worker deeply engaged in work with the refugee families in Dandakaranya, which is why those children were brought to Delhi and given this chance of being educated there. So this reconstructive effort, so maybe I was earlier overemphasizing the aspect of the traumatic effects, but there's also a kind of constructive work initiative. We saw that in the case of Anis Kidwai's, very courageous efforts after her husband was killed, as described in Azadi Ki Chhaon Mein, in the shadow of, in Freedom Shade, as it's been translated by Ayesha Kidwai. So she was involved in the constructive efforts to rebuild society in the wake of violence. She was part of the peace groups and was very much intensely involved in that effort to recreate perhaps the composite culture or the Ganga Jamuni Tehzeeb, which had been so severely damaged. So I think, therefore, intergenerational trauma must not be seen as something which only mechanically leads to repetition. There is also a creative engagement and the possibility of resistance and perhaps creative reenactment, which can allow for this working through.
Thank you, sir, for coming up with such a wonderful answer. And also I thank Shivali for coming up with such a wonderful question. I have quite a few questions coming up, sir. I mean,
yeah, sure. I'm free. As long as you have stamina for, I'm here.
Sir, we are ready to listen to you. I mean, we can
extend the time a little longer. Go on, it's 3 o'clock, but for those who are interested, we can go on. No problem.
Sir, actually, there is Renu Singh who has asked on your opinion on Gulzar Stobar Taxi.
Oh, yes, that's a good question again. So Gulzar Sahib, of course, as we know, was himself a partition refugee. He is a Sikh, as we know, and migrated across the border. So he has that experience. So in that sense, it's almost like a kind of first generation experience. But in his poem, which you're reading as part of the syllabus, his tribute to Toba Tek Singh, he's again paying tribute to Manto. So it's a kind of, once again, a folding back into that prior history. I really like the line towards the end of the poem. There are some madmen on this side of the border who still have to be sent back, and some madmen on that side who still have to be sent across. So the ironies of the continuing kind of situation of, madness here in a metaphoric sense of persistence, a persistent animosity, hatred, the cauldron of sectarian or communal violence. I think he is in line with you know, writers like Bhishan Sani, who edited a collection of stories titled Kitne Toba Tek Singh in Hindi literature. There's also Kamleshwar's famous story, Kitne Pakistan. So these creative representations of the event come from a kind of, with the benefit of memory, a memory which is fraught, of course, because the dualities which I earlier described still destabilize any sense of, say, unalloyed nostalgia about the past. And nostalgia can be crippling, as we know. We cannot just simply go back to a sense of Punjabiyat as it once was. There's no return. In effect, that's what history teaches us, that there's no straightforward kind of pathway back to a certain kind of idyllic past, and certainly not for those who are the victims of such forms of violence. So I think Gulzar, at some level, is poetically, therefore, giving Manto the credence he deserves in a new context where Manto acquires a kind of fresh salience as a writer whose story's value will not fade so easily. So in effect, it tropes again on Manto's story and reinvents the idiom of madness afresh in a very distinctive way. So I think it's a very good choice, a selection for this course.
Okay, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. We are moving on to the next question. I mean, Sahana, the question from Sahana, where she asks that in Toba Tek Singh, actually, how do the lunatics define Pakistan?
Okay, that's an interesting question. So as we have seen, the Radcliffe announcement came late. Of course, by the time the partitioning of the mad, I shouldn't say madhouses because it's politically incorrect, but the hospitals for the mentally ill, by the time the partitioning was decided upon, the lines had been pretty much drawn and decided upon. But for the patients, for the mentally ill in the story, as we recall, that still remains an uncertain exercise. We see that in the case of the young man who is a lawyer whose beloved is left behind in Amritsar, that whole representation of the sort of predicament of someone whose prospects are so direly affected, including even the prospects of practicing law, well, if he ever were to resume his practice. So the reference to Pakistan as a place where the sharp instruments may be sharpened, that is a more generalized reference to the kind of fearfulness of the idea of division, perhaps, rather than actual, obviously, historical referent. And finally, for Toba Tek Singh, I mean, he has attempted to decipher, as we know, the process which he has become part of, but no one has provided satisfactory answers, not even his friend who comes to visit him. Fazaldin also has no effective way of resolving this anxiety about where his village will be placed. So Pakistan remains a kind of perhaps more ambiguous zone for the lunatics. As we know, of course, this may be a reference to the truncated nature of Pakistan as it eventually emerged in historical terms. We could go back to history to trace the evolution of this idea from the Lahore Revolution of 1940 onwards. But eventually, once the decision was taken, Jinnah was forced to accept what he called eventually a moth-eaten Pakistan. And there were still some unresolved areas, especially Gurdaspur, which eventually came to India's side. And that's something which the Pakistani side was never really happy with. The question of Kashmir, the first war was fought after partition on the basis of that disagreement about the way in which part Kashmir would go. It may be useful for students to read Manto's satirical piece, Pandit Nehru's letter, Pandit Manto's letter, I beg your pardon, to Pandit Nehru. It's in our collection, Translating Partition. So there he writes a letter to one of the great leaders of India, and as someone who has a kind of link to Kashmir, bemoans all that has transpired in, however, once again, almost a very whimsical, absurdist kind of tone. So that's Manto for you. He will never give you a straightforward kind of picture. And I think, again, this you could think of, for the lunatics to put it in a nutshell, Pakistan has become a zone of indeterminacy. It's not a territorially located kind of space with clearly cut boundaries. So Manto's task is exactly that, to destabilize any notion of identification of place and territory kind of one on a one-to-one kind of basis. So thanks for that question.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot. I think we can take two more questions here. One would be by somebody who has named himself or herself as G. But that person has actually asked that, can we interpret Arundhati Roy's The Ministry of Utmost Happiness as a work of post-partition era depicting the aftermath of the partition in India?
Oh, interesting thought. Yes, certainly the you know, sort of rippling after effects are dealt with by Arundhati Roy. No one can really ignore the partition realities if they're serious about engaging with our contemporary situation. And she is one of the most serious of writers looking at it from a kind of activist angle, but also, as of course, as a very gifted writer does, trying to sort of understand this in all its multiple realities. I think what she is looking at is, yes, the multiple partitions of today. You could say is, if one to again broaden the scope of partition to encompass even a work like this, yes, she's looking at the kind of multiple fissures, multiple partition that still kind of beset us as a kind of post-colonial nation state. But since her focus is more on a kind of contemporary moment, it would not perhaps be appropriate to classify it as a work of partition literature if one is really thinking of that requirement that in partition literature there must be at least some kind of situatedness of the narration in that time frame, even if the later sort of effects are dealt with. But Arundhati doesn't dramatize any of the partition moments, as far as I recall. It's more the moment of today, and yes, the inheritance of the past is there. And if we've read partition literature, then we can recognize that some of our characters, especially those who are from that underprivileged, dislocated background, are reminiscent of some of the figures from the fragmented wreckage depicted in the great writing of the partition moment. Thank you for that.
All right. Thanks a lot, sir. Yeah, there are so many wonderful questions coming up one after another. I think, Mir, we will take your question at the end. We'll have to give the chance to some of the other people who are also trying to talk here. Pragya Paramita, I think she has a question where she wants to ask about the term Khalistan, which is again derived from the partition. And the term is still used. So he's asking is if this is the effect of transgenerational trauma. But I think transgeneration, that is what he meant. Transgenerational trauma, I think.
This is a complicated problem. I don't know if the term Khalistan is necessarily derived from the partition. In my understanding, of course, you see, at the time in 1947, there were various options on the table. So one of the options floated across by at least some people in the Sikh community, was of a united Punjab, an independent Punjab, even possibly an independent Punjab. Maybe firstly, they did not wish the partition to occur in which the way it did. And that sort of was not obviously implemented, did not occur. The Punjab was split up on these demographic grounds. And as a result, there were some lingering issues. History, of course, is a long one, so maybe I shouldn't go into too much of detail with respect to that, but one can think of the Punjabi Subha movement as an important step along the way, with Punjabis seeking to reclaim some of what they deem to have not come their way. The question of the language, with Hindus not signing up as with Punjabi as the first language, that lingering sense of hostility and resentment. The whole host of factors which led up to the movement which then consciously took on the description Khalistan. I don't think this can be just attributed to trauma. I think it has a kind of socio-political dimension, which we can leave to another discussion. Jarnail Singh Bhadrawale as the and the politics of the Congress Party of the time, it will take us in a totally different direction. I mean, we have memories of that. More perhaps appropriately for the questioner, I would say, go to the films of Gurinder Singh. He's one of the finest Punjabi filmmakers. And he's actually grappled with him and Ajay Bhardwaj, the documentary filmmaker Ajay Bhardwaj. If you really want to understand the workings of intergenerational trauma and the effects that partition had in the Punjab, please see these wonderful films some I could mention, but you can just search on the net and you'll find them. Gurinder Singh and Ajay Bhardwaj. They'll really reveal to you so much more than just these terms might about intergenerational transmission.
Okay. Thanks a lot, sir. We will take two more questions, then we'll move on to Mir, and I think after that we'll be winding up our wonderful session that we have. Right now, I'll invite our colleague Sumita Sharma to ask her question.
Oh yes, sure.
Hi again, Tarun. You are an SF scholar and also an SF writer, and I'm referring here to your recent futuristic story set in 2047, which Visit to Partitioned World, where we have a Westworld style theme park, except the theme here is partition, right? And now I do understand that, gamification has its therapeutic aspects, building resilience or providing coping mechanisms and all. But the setting of this story is 2047. And at that time, most likely there would be no living person with any memory of this, right? So there is, of course, always cultural memory. So would you say that, were such a theme park to be built actually, would it still, go on to fulfill some kind of collective need to access traumatic past in this manner? Is this also some kind of memorialization, or would it, just remain something, on the surface without, providing that kind of access, really? I mean, what is your own motivation in writing the story, telling the story?
I can see a very interesting interpretation of the story in the making, in the question which you've asked. I hope you'll actually eventually get around to interpreting the story in a insightful light. Because, I could explain it away, would that help matters? Not really. It would be perhaps an oversimplification. But what I can do is maybe say one or two things with reference to the concept of post-memory. Because I think implicit in your question is this reference to what is going to happen when all the people who are alive are no longer around. And as a result, we don't have access to primary recollections, which is what has made the work of the archivists so crucial in recent times. And there has been a kind of manifestation of what I would term hyperamnesia. So what is hyperamnesia? It's the opposite of amnesia. That is to say, an inability to forget. When the mind is so crowded by memory that it's almost as if you are unable to process and differentiate between various facets of the memories coming your way. And this phenomenon has been witnessed even with respect to victims of the Holocaust. And I think it has a relevance in our context as well, this idea of hyperamnesia. Now, Marianne Hirsch is the sort of theorist and critic who's best known for positing this notion of post-memory, a notion which again is relevant for a reading of Maus, which she interprets in her book on the subject, and perhaps also Vishwajyoti Ghosh's collection. Memories which inform the present, even though we don't personally hold those memories, that is to say, they are generational memories, which through silences, through even sometimes the absence of the actual questions which beset us, nonetheless, those continue to haunt us. And our sort of own life, it may be even evacuated, she suggests, as a result of the pressures of this memory coming from a deeply traumatized past of the previous generation. So I think post-memory is a very suggestive notion to take forward. Ananya Kabir has in her book, Partitions Post-Amnesia, pushed this debate even further by speaking of our context as being a post-amnesiac context, where we're moving beyond amnesia to these multiple sort of modes of recuperation, whether it's the Partition Archives Project, you know, launched by Gunita Singh Bhalla from Berkeley, and which has spread out all across South Asia and across the world to collect survivor memories, whether it is the Partition Museum in Amritsar. So now coming back to my story, which you asked about. So I wrote the story in a satirical light. So maybe it was in the context of so much of that is of all that is happening today. As ever, you know, what does science fiction do? It projects events and concerns of the present into the future. That estrangement effect, which you know rather well, and eventually, hopefully, there's a kind of comment on the present, which is us in the process. So let me just signpost one development which I came across after writing this story. So there are some people, I forget the name of the organization, but they are based in the US, and they have devised a kind of virtual reality technology, a simulation of partition streets and partition era streets and some experiences and memories. And they sort of have made this into a kind of like, you know, second life, a kind of virtual experience. And now they are sort of inviting survivors of the partition to revisit their memories after first immersing themselves in this kind of 3D sort of simulated space. So, my sense is that, to address again the brunt of your question, if I may do so indirectly, is that I'm not sure whether such spectacular or simulation-based reenactments would necessarily provide catharsis. As you recall in the story, there's a kind of rather critical view of the notion, which sometimes is too easily arrived at, of our being able to arrive at catharsis through such sort of perhaps ways of being sort of faced with our past, whether in the form of museum symbols like the giant cleaver in the Amritsar Museum, or the well which is actually being, you know, sort of placed in the museum, which is supposed to remind us of the Thoa Khalsa well, where the women, you know, jumped in to commit suicide. So I therefore have my reservations about institutionalized memorialization, which can also become pathological at some level. And it's a worrisome trend. So maybe I should leave it at that, because otherwise I'll be giving away the game. You should read the story and make your own inferences about the real sort of intentions that which were perhaps underlying my attempt to perhaps once again provide a kind of SF take on this very traumatic history, and to kind of take it forward into a perhaps scenario where it might take this new form of an amusement park like Westworld. As it might be. Yeah. So I'll think about it further, but thanks for the question.
Thanks a lot for coming up with this wonderful discussion here. I think we have Amrita Valla ma'am out here, and she has commented on Garam Hawa. I'd request Amrita Valla ma'am to come and
Yeah, Amrita, would you like to say something?
I would like the host to please unmute Amrita Bhalla.
Absolutely fascinating, Tarun. Absolutely fascinating. And I was thinking of Ismat Chughtai's Garam Hawa, Balraj Sahni acting in it, a film not very, very popular, but what an outstanding film. And I was also thinking of Gulzar's Machis when you mentioned Gurinder Singh, the Punjabi director.
Yeah.
These two films, though a film, I must say, can never depict what the written word does. I'm teaching Bapsi Sidwa's Ice Candy Man, made into Earth 1947, and Pinjar, Amrita Pritam Swinjar, made also into a film. We saw Khamosh Pani. Sukrita read a passage, the part was screened. The novel written words are outstanding, absorbing. Do you think a film can reproduce? Think of Khamosh Pani, think of Pinjar, think of Machis, think of Garam Hawa.
Yeah. True, true. I mean, these are all landmarks, of course. Yes. We might take it further back, actually, and once again, not to anyway, underplay the significance of the partition in the East. It's no accident, perhaps, that Ritik Ghatak made his famous trilogy of films in the immediate aftermath. And so like Manto did with respect to the partition in the West, I think Ghatak captured the situation of refugee life and the difficult compromises of making the readjustment. And the underlying, what again, Bhaskar Sarkar calls the melancholia. Melancholia in Freud's description, this is an unresolved form of, well, melancholy. Melancholy may be a condition we live with, but when it afflicts us in such a way that it almost paralyzes our capacity to act, our will.
Oh, that's absolutely. Absolutely.
That's
absolutely
brilliantly brought out in Ritik Ghatak's film. And Garam Hawa did was, yes, absolutely, home in on the situation of the quote-unquote nationalist Muslim, those who decided to stay on. But Rajasthani is so brilliant, sort of capturing that very courageous decision in the face of relentless hostility and othering.
Yes.
But ultimately, the last scenes of the film are
last scene. Yes, absolutely.
He decides not to migrate.
Not to migrate.
Steps, however, into a kind of different form of
protest.
Of solidarity. And,
yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
So there are alternatives which may have become now almost once again historic in terms of the options available, but they haven't entirely disappeared.
They aren't, Thank you.
Khamosh Pani as a more recent example of once again this negotiation with trauma that persists into the experience of those who grow up and very children may be alienated from them. As a respect,
as it's been judged.
Consolidation of fundamentalist attitudes, as we saw in the depiction of the Zia era, experience.
Yes, fundamentalism.
Hindu has become a Muslim and has brought her to as a Muslim, finds her son turning against her and ultimately commits suicide. So the self-destructive aspects. The spiraling self-destructiveness which can ensue from unresolved trauma is so brilliantly captured.
Brilliant, absolutely, absolutely. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, Rajeshwari, can I have a last question? I mean, I think Mir Muhammad Ali, he wants to ask one more. Can we wind up with his question?
Yes, I think so.
Yeah, all and right, okay.
It's up to you now.
I'm okay. Yeah. No, it's a good question. Shall I read it out? So
It is.
Apart from Anirudh Kala's story, Folio D, in the Unsafe Asylum collection, where the repressed trauma of a mother is transferred to her offspring, have you encountered any other text of that kind apart from Kala? That's a tough one. I'll have to think about it. It's a researcher's question, which is a very good sign. I'm always happy to find researchers asking such searching questions. One would have to look around, I guess. But I can't think of any, except that perhaps, again, one could think of, again, Khamosh Pani in that light, where the mother's decision not to reveal the truth about her Hindu identity very silencing of that prior history leads to a situation where the son becomes even more unlikely to take her side when ultimately that reality is against her will disclosed. So it's ironic. It's presented in an ironic light, while in the story in Kala's collection, the causative factors perhaps are more clearly visible, and the sort of sense of a whole family getting enveloped by this kind of collective pattern of behavior, which is highly irrational, highly self-destructive, sort of therefore ensues. So yeah, maybe that's an interesting contrast that could be established. Yeah, a kind of deliberate silencing, which results in nonetheless a kind of very unfortunate outcome. In contrast to their situation where it just does not seem to be in the hands, it's not deliberate. The unconscious mechanisms seem to play much more of a determinative role and ultimately lead to the destruction of the entire family unit, one after the other. So the psychiatrist then becomes the mute witness to it. But that's the layeredness of the human psyche. Again, a point I take from Nandi, and his writings are always worth looking back to in his various collection, that there's a layeredness to the human psyche, to human consciousness, and we all need to, of course, keep that in mind. There's never a simple, say, victim-perpetrator situation when it comes, especially also in the context of, once again, the partition history and partition, after effects and aftermath. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. And I thank all the people who came up with such wonderful questions. And I really thank, sir, for giving so much of time for these questions. I now ask Rajeshwari to take forward the session.
We can't hear you. You need to unmute.
Rajeshwari, ma'am, I think you have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, am I audible now? Yes, yeah. Thank you, Raj Rishi. And thank you so much, sir, for such a wonderful and nice talk upon what partition. And you accepted our proposal and spare your precious time for us. Thank you very much again. Now I would like to thank other people who are present or not present here. I actually especially thank to our senior most, Annie Thomas Rosa. I think she's not here, but yes, she is there, means like a driving force for me, who worked, who inspired me that yes, you should do something. I'm thankful to all my colleagues in his department, especially Raj Rishi, Sumita, Shivali, Anuj is not here. And thanks to our principal, although he could not make to this talk, but always I know that he always inspired the people to take some steps towards doing some activities in the college. Thank you to Sumanji and his entire team for the technological support, who always ready for us whenever we ask him. Thank you to all the participants also who have joined us today to hear our speaker and show their interest in this webinar. Thanks all the students of the college and outside the college who have joined us. And thank you everyone to spare their time. And I'm thankful to Shyamlal College itself. Actually, now we miss that building also. If it would be offline, so I think that would be a better thing for us. Now we really miss. It's not a building only for us. It's like a heaven. We go and really enjoy our life. A fair part of our life is spent there. So thank you, everyone. Thanks a lot.
I would like to ask everybody to, I think if you can, if you're willing, please actually turn your cameras on so that we can have our mandatory selfie, mandatory screenshot of her. I'd like the host to take
I think you, Sumita can do that.
I'm doing it.
I'll just wait for a few moments to...
If we can have some more people.
Yeah, it's always nice to see the faces of the listeners. I always prefer that. Of course, you can't while what's going on Zoom.
Yeah.
But face to face.
Yeah, and this is the morning server. Everyone here. Yeah.
Right. I think I've taken a few. So.
Okay.
So.
Thank you, Sumita.
Everybody's eyes are open and
I think there are only two pages, right? That's a bridge.
Right. So
yeah. Well, okay, I think now we can end this lecture formally. Yes.
A footnote, if I may.
Yes.
Noticed that Shyamalal College is not far from is in Shahadra, right? So
yes.
You may be surprised to know that Delhi had no mental asylum from 1899
yes.
to
1960.
Plans had been laid for a mental asylum, but people who were mentally ill had to go to Amritsar if they were to be confined or treated in a institutionalized space. So it was only in 1960 that, I guess you know that very well, in Shahadra area, the asylum was finally constructed. But so that's another connection.
Thank you, sir. Okay, sir. I think we can end the session now. Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
everyone. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, Sumanji is here.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, we can. Yes. Yeah, Sumita.
Yeah.
Can close the session?
Yep.
Yes, we can close it now. Yes.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Gaurav ji.
Okay, ma'am. You're welcome.
Okay. Bye.